Well, it's grateful. I'm grateful to be here tonight to be able to teach. It's, I guess, one of my first official teaching times. And I'm going to start off with my testimony. And before I do that, if you have a mind like mine, I'm going to ask you to do something tonight. I'm going to ask you to just take your minds and pull them in right now. Lose what's outside. Take what was troubling you when you walked into the room tonight and just let it stay out there. And then interferences, just set them down because they're going to be there when you leave. So right now, let's just listen in closely to what God's Word has to say to our hearts and let that be what intervenes in our hearts tonight and not all the busyness that we left when we came in here. So I would like to open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you tonight for you being willing to let me just speak your word, and I ask tonight that the Holy Spirit would have complete control and that you would be glorified and honored through it. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. You already know my name is Jim Franzen, and I go to High Point Church. This is my wife here, Dana Franzen. She came to support me. I needed a cheerleader tonight, so anyway, I have one, official. So I do go to High Point Church. I've been there 3 years pretty much now. And before that, I lived in Prairie City and went to church over in Monroe for several years. And anyway, I'll just get right back down into my childhood and then work my way up to that. I was born and raised in southern Iowa. I lived in a little town called La Villa. I grew up in a coal mine type town. It was dump trucks mostly. If they didn't work a John Deere or Maytag, they were dump truck drivers. And my dad and grandpa and uncle all owned trucks, and that's how I grew up in the trucking business. And when I was in the on the weekends, they always worked on the trucks, so I'll just jump right into what got me started into alcohol. So during the weekends, they would work on the trucks, change tires, change oil, grease them, and of course, always the beers broke out about noon to 2 o'clock, and me running around, I'd always sneak a drink here and a drink there, and kind of got to liking that taste. I acquired a taste for it. And that's kind of what got me started drinking beer, and then I got into my mid-teens and started doing it on a regular basis and became a weekend warrior, as you would call it. That's what got me started drinking. And with that said, I'm going to say between age 10 and 12, my mom started going to church. She was invited to an evangelistic meetings a week in a church, and she got saved there. And she started telling me about Christ and telling me who Jesus was and what he had done for me. And I didn't want nothing to do with it. Of course, I had to go to church. She encouraged me to go to church, pushed me to go to church, and made me go to church. And the whole time, I didn't care for it. But there was one evening at an evangelistic meeting that I went to with her. She had me go 1 week. And there was a man that preached. And he, before the evening was over, he had taken me off to the side. And he had told me about Jesus Christ and who I was as a sinner. I don't remember a lot of the details because that's a long time ago. But I do remember, though, he asked me if I wanted to trust in Jesus Christ for salvation. And I just kind of sat there and I wasn't really sure. I was scared. I didn't know what to do. And then finally he got ready to leave and I said, you know what, I want to do that. So we turn around in chairs about like this, which they was metal. And I prayed and asked Christ to save me that night. And I remember it very well because the next day was the big day. I had three of my best friends that I had went down the street and played with, and we were all outside, and I told them, I says, guess what, guys? I got saved last night. He, what? I said, I trusted in Jesus Christ, and I get to go to heaven now. And it made them very mad. They said, shut up. We don't want to hear this. And I pretty much just quit talking about it up until I was 19 years old. So from that time until I was 19 years old, I lived quite a wildlife in a sense with alcohol and living in a way that was, I call hedonism, and was looking back now, I seen that I was becoming conditioned by the secular world viewpoint and very hard so. And as I got older, trucking became a very big interest of mine, and I knew I was wanting to go truck, so I got into the trucking business. And as I started trucking, I got introduced to a drug called methamphetamine. We called it crank. And I'm fast-forwarding my testimony tonight so I can get something done with Hebrews. So anyway, I got involved in meth, and a guy introduced me to it. And man, did it wake me up. And you know, I could truck. And what I used it for was just simply trucking to the West Coast. I hauled meat out. I brought produce back. And the only way you could keep the pace they asked you to keep was have another driver or do what I was doing, using meth. And that's how I got introduced to it. You know, for 2 or 3 years, I had no idea. Lee, are you here tonight? Where's Lee? I thought I'd seen Lee. There he is. You said something one night when you spoke, and it really rang true with me. And I didn't know I was an addict when I was an addict, even. I was using it regularly. It was just a help for me to get to the West Coast and back. And when I got back, I never touched it. It wasn't something to party on, or I wasn't trying to escape from some brutal life or some sort, or just problems in life I was not trying to escape from. It was just a source to keep me going. But later on, I realized I was addicted to it and did not realize that. Well, as that life went on, I started meeting more people and got in deeper. And they introduced me to this person introduced me to this person. And each step I took, it took me in deeper until I had enjoyed it to a point. It wasn't so much about the drug no more. It was the power I had with the drug is what became appealing to me. And then I was introduced to what we call a drug lord. There's a guy down in Marino, California. I got to go to his house and was introduced to him and become quite good friends with him and his wife. And he asked me to be a carrier for him. We call them mules. And I agreed to do that. And I started then hauling a kilo of crank from California back to Des Moines, Iowa. So please don't start throwing things at me if you're one of my problem childs. Anyway, so that's what I started doing. I got involved in it, and I started doing that. And Frank was a drug lord, and he had a house he went to was a drug family. They were the family. Some people consider them the mob, but they were a family that you could only get into is if you were willing to basically just give your life to them. And you did what they said. If there was any problems in your life, they took care of it. Well, he took me there one night, and he had convinced them I was trustworthy and it was somebody that they could use and not worry about anything going wrong. And so we drove up to the place we was going to go into, and he asked me to stay in the truck, in his pickup. He said he wanted to go in and talk to him before I came in. And he came back out. He goes, okay, he says, you're clear to come in. He says, but Jim, he goes, I want to get really, really serious with you right now. He says, if you come in, you're in. This is a family that you're going to come into, and you're going to be a part of it. You cannot walk out of there and walk out free, because if you do, there's going to be consequences. And the consequences basically won't be on you. There'll be other ways they take care of issues because of your rebellion against them. So he said, I want you to sit here in the truck and think about it. If you don't come in, they don't care. That's fine. They're cool with that. Just stay in the truck and nothing will be thought of it. And because of my pride and my want to be of that level of power, it was hard not to walk in that door, because that appealed to me, to have that type of power is what I'll call it. And by God's grace, I sat in the truck that night. I stayed. And after I left there that night, it wasn't long after that I knew things were wrong. I was headed the wrong way. I had another friend of mine tell me in a pretty rough way that I was really screwing up. He says, you're at the wrong place, Jim. And he goes, I know what's going on. And he says, you're going to go down. Well, it wasn't long after that. I had a kilo in my truck. I'd left the money with him and put the kilo in my truck. I had it hid very well. It was sealed them up pretty tight. And out of nowhere, there was like 12 to 15 cops that just swarmed me going down the freeway. And one pulled beside me, sort of wishing me over into the ditch, and they had a great big open ditch, and I pulled into that big ditch, and my thing's going to really go long here, Dave. I'm sorry. So anyway, I got pulled over into this ditch, and at this time, my ex-wife and I were having some terrible marital problems, and that's why she was with me that week. We were trying to see what we were going to do with our life. And when I got pulled over, the guy asked me where I had left. And I told him, I said, I just left Marino, California. And I said, why did you pull me over? And he goes, you were speeding. I said, I wasn't speeding. He goes, well, you were. And he says, now we have you here. He says, do you mind if we search your truck? I says, yeah, I mind. I says, if you got paperwork to prove that you can do that. And I said, you need a warrant. And he goes, well, if you want to sit here that long for me to get a warrant, then I'll do that. And here I go getting into that long story, so I'll try to keep pushing this forward. Anyway, he searched my truck, came back out, and asked me then if he could put a dog in it. And then I freaked out. I didn't let him know I was freaked out, but I knew I was done. I knew I'd been had. And the thing that bothered me most was I knew I was going to get busted. And what really bothered me, though, was that my ex-wife had no idea that that stuff was in there. And she was going to go down. And that bothered me more than anything. Well, the cop that went in with the dog, she had a mirror up in one of the shelves. It had dropped that going down that week, and it broke, and she just had a little piece of it left, and it had hairspray all over it. After he'd been in there probably 35, 40 minutes, he came out with his mirror. He walks up to me, and he says, "What's this?" And I'm in relief, wanting to go, "Well, it's hairspray." And he says, "Are you sure?" I said, "I'm positive." And he goes, "Well," handed the mirror to me, and he says, "You're free to go." And I almost went, "Are you serious?" So anyway, that day I knew God gave me a choice. And you know, I was saved, and this is what I was doing. I had become a child of God that had walked away into a different world. I drifted. I went back into a life that I was appeasing myself and living a life of hedonism, is what I call it. Hedonism, it's just pleasures, all kinds of pleasures, doing what makes me happy. And I knew then God was telling me that if you stay in, you're going down. And the following week, I went back to Frank and gave him his money and told him I wasn't delivered no more. And he wasn't very happy about that. But anyway, from that step forward, he started cleaning my life up. One night coming down I-15 was the moment that I finally told God that I got on my knees in my sleeper and I told him, I said that, you know, I like this life. I like the attention. And I says, I really don't want to leave it, but I need to leave it because you are my God and you're my Savior. And I'm truly not living for you at all. And I'm miserable. And anyhow, one step led to another and I finally started getting let out of the drug scene. And then I got into the place where I got myself set up where I could sell the truck and trailer, came home, got off the road, and started living for the Lord. I got involved in a church there in Prairie City, and moving on through life real quick here, I got into alcohol quite a bit. And then a few years ago, not too long ago, 10 years ago, I went through a real bad case of depression to the point that I did not want to get out of bed. I was so depressed, so miserable. I was just medicating myself with alcohol. And anyway, I got hooked up with a guy named Jariah Shank. Does anybody know Jariah Shank in here? Anyway, Jariah Shank means a lot to me. God put him in my life. So I praise God for that man because he broke into my life and he showed me what love meant when you told him the truth. And each time I met with that guy, I'd tell him more truth, and I'd tell him more truth. Even when I was doing wrong, I was telling him I was doing it wrong, and he continued to love on me and showed me who Christ was. He got me on track. He started discipling me, Don. Are you hearing me, Don? Jennings? He started discipling me one-on-one, as he was talking about. And what he done was is he started walking me through the Bible of what happened to me at my salvation, and we made sure I was saved, and he was convinced I was. And Jariah got me back on track. Well, God did through Jariah. And then I ended up in a divorce and ended up moving into Altoona and got into High Point Church. And then lo and behold, God wasn't done with me. He still wanted me discipled by somebody. He dropped me into a guy's name, Ray Burns. And Ray Burns is a guy that took over and started discipling me quite regularly. We don't meet as much now as we used to, but praise God that he put Ray Burns in my life. And I say that to say this, is if you don't have an accountability person that you meet with one-on-one on a regular basis, especially if you're new in the faith and needs to be pretty regular, I encourage you to do that. It's very necessary to let somebody speak in your life one-on-one. And if you're not doing that, I ask you to do that. I just pray that you do that. So anyway, Ray got abruptly introduced to me. When I ran up to him one day in church, said, "Hey, you Ray Burns!" And I said, I want you to disciple me. Chris Lenore told me all about you. And then, so I kind of scared him. But anyway, he stuck with me. Who is this crazy guy? But anyway, God now has put a woman that loves Christ in my life. And her and I together serve Christ together now. And it's wonderful. I've never had a relationship or fellowship with a woman in my entire life as I have you, Dana. And it's wonderful to be able to serve the Lord with a woman in my life that it's just nice harmony. And anyway, I love that. So God has brought me that far to where I'm at today. I started coming to GCR because I wanted to be a part of it because of my past to start with. And then I got to the place I wanted to serve. So Dave let me start doing table leading. And then I got brave enough to try this. And I would like to see God move me into growing more now. I figure this is what a place to start. If Dave let me continue to speak, then I can maybe let Ray continue to hone me and get me to where I'm supposed to be. So anyway, tonight I'm going to open up with the book of Hebrews. That's my goal here tonight. And so Hebrews chapter 1 is what I'm going to start with. And I'll do a little forecast, give you a little idea what's going on here. The author is an unknown author of Hebrews. I think probably most of us know that. But the nice thing about this, that even though he does not identify himself, we do know the author. His name is God, the Holy Spirit. 2 Timothy 3:16 tells us that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. So we know the book is good. It's got an author behind it that used a man to write it. And he is a Jew, and he is writing to Jewish people. And actually, in these Jewish people, he's addressing three distinct groups of Jews. The first group that he's talking to are primarily a group of Christ followers. They had gotten saved, but they were still suffering under persecution and rejection by their fellow Jews. And I'll read it real quick here. In Hebrews 10:32-34, there's an account that it says, "But remember the former days when, after being enlightened, you endured a great conflict of suffering, partly by being made public and spectacles through reproaches and afflictions, and partly by becoming sharers with those who were treated. For you also showed sympathy to the prisoners and accepted with joy the seizure of the possession of your possessions, knowing that you have yourselves a better and lasting possession, which is Christ." And the letter he's writing to them, and he's trying to encourage them here. But they were young in their faith, and they were tempted still to hold on to their symbolic symbols and still follow some of the Judaism ways. And as we read here, he talks to them and he writes this letter. We're listening in on their conversation here. He starts out with by saying, "God having spoken long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions and in many ways, and these last days has spoken to us in his Son." So he identifies with them, is what I'm going to say right off the bat. He identifies the fact that God did speak in a different way in an old covenant that he had. He spoke to them through the prophets, to the fathers, and he did it in many ways, at many times, and they would identify with this. And what he's trying to do now is show them, as I'm going to go into it now, there's a transition that takes place here right now. So we come out of the old covenant into the new covenant now. And he says, "But in these last days, he has spoke to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds, who is a radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power, who, having accomplished cleansing for our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high." Let me get caught up in here where I want to talk a little bit about that. I got my pages kind of messed up here. But what we see to start off with is that Jesus is the Son of God. When he starts talking about who he is here, he appointed him heir of all things. And now I'm getting off my notes a little bit, so I'm getting a little messed up here. So bear with me. And anyway, he was appointed heir of all things, and God brought the universe into being by the agency of his Son. And we continue to see who the Son is by even other authors, as Paul writes to the church of Colossians in chapter 1, verse 16. He says, "For through him, Christ, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on the earth. He made the things we can see. He made the things we can see, the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him." when God came into the world, he was bringing forth a progressive truth through the Old Testament, through the forefathers, by the prophets. He was bringing the truth forward, which was going to be Christ, is who he's going to be. So when Christ comes onto the scene, he says, now he speaks to us in his Son. It is actually God. He's a revelation of God climaxes who Christ is. That's who he is. God is actually fully expressing himself in his Son. And he comes in, this author goes on now, as he starts talking about the Son, identifying who he is as being God, what he had done, he had created. He was the absolute representation of God. He goes on now, he says, for to which of the angels did he ever say? And of course, they were worshiping angels yet. I should have said that before this. And he says, for to which of the angels did he ever say, you are my Son? Today I have begotten you. None. He says, and when he again brings the firstborn into the world, he says, and let all the angels of God worship him. So the angels will be worshiping Christ. And this is trying to get their identification away from where they were at, as seeing the difference in the power of who Christ was versus him. I had a whole lot of things to say here tonight, and I'm going to run out of time, but...
Let's go for 7:15,
Jim. Okay. I'll relax then. I'm going to slow down. So I guess I got ahead of myself, and there was three different groups of people I had talked about, and I guess I would ask you which one of those that you find yourself in tonight. Are you saved and following Christ? Or are you one of those that have head knowledge of it and it hasn't gone to your heart yet? It's just head knowledge, not heart knowledge, that you've really truly put your trust in him. Or are you one that just have heard of him and you're running in the other direction and you don't care? That's for you to identify. And here in this GCR ministry is a very good place to learn where you stand and if you're in the right place and if you're not, to be taught how to get there. So as we go on here, what we can see first of all in the first four verses is this, is God made Christ heir of all things. He is better than the angels. Through him, he made all things. He is better than the angels. He is the radiance of God's glory. He is better than the angels. He sustains all things by his powerful word. He is better than the angels. After he had provided purification, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. He is better than the angels. In the Old Testament, the priests would go once a year into the Holy of Holies and they would sacrifice a sacrifice for all the people's sins. But they never ever come out of there and took a seat because it was finished. They never did that. When Jesus Christ came to earth and he died for our sins and God laid all of our sins on him and punished him for it, Christ raising from the dead, overcoming death, then went to the Father, and he sat down at the right hand of the Father. Why? Because it's finished. Amen. Our sins are taken care of. Never again will there have to ever be anything done for our sins. Nothing we can do. All we can do is humble our hearts to God and realize what we are before him and accept his gift of eternal life through what he's done in Christ. My whole purpose tonight in trying to teach this is to help you see who Christ is. He is the key here tonight. There was people in that day that was trying to drift away back into their ways of the old worship style. And I would challenge you tonight and my own self. Are we trying to fade back into some of our old worship styles? I recently will confess tonight. I'll just tell you just recently what happened to me. I'm going through a med change. And this med change has really been screwing with me. And it's really had my head really foggy, gloomy, and very uncomfortable emotionally. And for some reason, I have been really wanting to drink again. I've been wanting to feed myself alcohol. And I'll just confess that to the public, Dave. And I couldn't understand that because I didn't, 2 years ago anyway, I never even cared about alcohol. But it's been a little over a year now. I don't know, a little over a year. I've been fogging up and kind of dancing around with this thing. And I had slipped a few times, and not slipped, purposely did it. But I was able to do something, and this is what I want to tell you this for. What happened yesterday was I was able to nail down what the trigger was. I saw it, and I examined my heart continuously. Why was I wanting to drink again? I know how foolish it is. I know what a liar it is. It's a thief. It will make you a bondage of it, rather than being a bondage, or not bondage, but a child of God and freedom. And I was puzzled with that. But what I finally found out was that the way I was conditioned in my life and hardwired was the old person of me was rearing its head. It was wanting to fix it. I was wanting to fix myself again with alcohol. I was wanting to medicate myself because I didn't like the way I felt. And that was my tradition, because that's the way I felt when I had depression. Well, I wasn't that bad. Now I'm not that bad. But that's what I did then. I medicated myself with alcohol. That got me to my happy place. And now here recently, I couldn't figure out why this kept coming up. And now, yesterday, praise God, I realized I was wanting to fix myself again because the meds that I'm changing from and to aren't doing their job. And so, praise God. So if you're flirting with drifting and wanting to float back into your idols or to your arena of where you found your fun at, I would encourage you to examine your heart. We need to examine our hearts. Why the triggers? Where did the trigger come from? Find out what made that trigger go off and shut it down. Nip it in the bud. And so as we've talked about Christ and as we've talked about who the angels were, they was worshiping them again, and the author is telling them, no, it's the Son. And so it's obvious the prophets and the angels are no equality with Jesus Christ is what the author has really struck out to show them here. And from Chuck Swindoll's commentary, I've made some notes. I'm going to just read them to you. And he says some pretty cool stuff here. It's just some thoughts that I thought would be interesting to share with you. Christ, he had a preeminence. He surpassed all superiority. There was nothing above him, nothing equal with him. He had no wealth or influence here on earth and had no training or education in the world schools. Stop and think about that. Who was Christ? But yet he didn't have none of that. His relatives were inconspicuous. They had nothing that attracted others. That's where he come from. In his infancy, he startled a king. Jesus did. In his boyhood, he puzzled learned doctors. Remember when his mom and dad goes back and finds him at the synagogue teaching the teachers? He's a boy. Was he special or was he not? He was better than the angels. And he healed multitudes without medicine and made no charges for his efforts. He never wrote a book, and yet all the libraries in the world could not hold the books about him. He never founded a college, yet all the schools together cannot boast of as many students. He never practiced medicine, and yet has healed more broken hearts than all the doctors have healed broken bones. Throughout history, great men have come and gone, yet he lives on. Herod could not kill him. Satan could not seduce him. Death could not destroy him. And the grave could not hold him, praise God. He is risen. And I'm going to just go ahead and stop right there. I'm kind of losing my way here. It's my first time doing this. So I guess, Ray, as you've told me, some of my bubbles and things, I will learn by this and I'll get better as I go along. But anyway, I want to thank you for taking your time to listen to me tonight. It's my goal for you to know who Christ is and that he is the way, the truth, and life. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you.